filled with Brahman are the things we see. Filled with Brahman are the things we see not. From out of Brahman floweth all that is. From Brahman all, yet is he still the same. That is full, this is full, this fullness has been projected from that fullness. When this fullness merges in that fullness, all that remains is fullness. Om, peace, peace, peace be unto all.
Before Vivekananda was born, Ramakrishna had a vision. He later narrated what he saw. One day, I found that my mind was soaring high in samadhi along a luminous path. It soon transcended the stellar universe and entered the subtler region of ideas. As it ascended higher and higher, I found on both sides of the way ideal forms of gods and goddesses. The mind then reached the outer limits of that region, where a luminous barrier separated the sphere of relative existence from that of the absolute. Crossing that barrier, the mind entered the transcendental realm where no corporeal being was visible. Even the gods dared not peep into that sublime realm, but had to be content to keep their seats far below. The next moment, I found seven venerable sages seated there in samadhi. It occurred to me that these sages must have surpassed not only men, but even the gods, in knowledge and holiness, in renunciation and love. Lost in admiration, I was reflecting on their greatness when I saw a portion of that undifferentiated luminous region condense into the form of a divine child. The child came to one of the sages, tenderly clasped his neck with his lovely little arms, and addressing him in a sweet voice, attempted to drag his mind down from the state of samadhi. The magic touch roused the sage from his superconscious state, and he fixed his unmoving, half-open gaze upon that wonderful child. His beaming countenance showed that the child must have been the treasure of his heart. In great joy, the strange child said to him, "I am going down. You too must go with me." The sage remained mute, but his tender look expressed his assent. As he kept gazing on the child, he was again immersed in samadhi. I was surprised to find that a fragment of the sage's body and mind was descending on earth in the form of an effulgent light. No sooner had I seen Naren than I recognized him to be that sage who later became Swami Vivekananda. Subsequent inquiry elicited from Sri Ramakrishna the admission that the divine child was none other than himself. Vivekananda's mother, Bhuvaneshwari Devi, wrote to an old aunt of the Datta family in Varanasi, asking her to make the necessary offerings and prayers to Vireshwar Shiva that a son might be born to her. It was arranged that on Mondays, the aunt would offer worship to Vireshwar Shiva, while Bhuvaneshwari would practice special austerities on those days. It is said that by observing a vow of this sort for 1 year, one is blessed with a son. Thus, Bhuvaneshwari was content to wait in perfect assurance that her prayers would be answered. She spent her days in practicing japa and meditation. She observed fasts and intensified her many other austerities, her whole soul given over to constant recollectedness, her heart fixed in love on the Lord Shiva. In her dream, she saw the Lord Shiva rouse himself from his meditation and take the form of a male child who was to be her son. She awoke. Could this ocean of light in which she found herself bathed be but a dream? Shiva, Shiva. The light of the world dawned for the first time upon the future Swami Vivekananda on Monday, January 12th, 1863. Vivekananda first met Ramakrishna when he was 18. Ramakrishna described the first visit. Narendra entered this room by the western door. He seemed indifferent about his body and dress, and unlike other people, not mindful of the external world. His eyes bespoke an introspective mind, as if some part of it were always concentrated on something within. I was surprised to find such a spiritual soul coming from the material atmosphere of Calcutta. On inquiry, I came to know that he had learnt 3 or 4 Bengali songs. I asked him to sing them. He began singing the Brahmo song, which begins,
"Let us go back once more, O mind, to our own abode. Here in this foreign land of earth, why should we wander aimlessly in stranger's guise? These living beings round about and the 5 elements are strangers to you, all of them. None is your own. Why do you thus forget yourself in love with strangers, O my mind? Why do you thus forget your own?"
One day, Vivekananda asked Ramakrishna, "Sir, have you seen God?" Ramakrishna replied, "Yes, I see him just as I see you here, only in a much intenser sense. God can be realized," he went on. "One can see and talk to him as I am seeing and talking to you, but who cares? People shed torrents of tears for their wife and children, for wealth or property, but who does so for the sake of God? If one weeps sincerely for him, he surely manifests himself." That impressed me at once. For the first time, I found a man who dared to say that he had seen God, that religion was a reality to be felt, to be sensed in an infinitely more intense way than we can sense the world. Vivekananda's father died in 1884, leaving the family in debt. Vivekananda had no job to provide for his family. Although he denounced image worship, poverty forced him to approach Sri Ramakrishna and request him to plead with Mother Kali on his behalf. The master, however, sent Narendra to pray personally, and he later expressed his experience thus. Reaching the temple, as I cast my eyes upon the image, I actually found that the Divine Mother was living and conscious, the perennial fountain of divine love and beauty. I was caught in a surging wave of devotion and love. In an ecstasy of joy, I prostrated myself again and again before the Mother and prayed. Mother, give me discrimination. Give me renunciation. Give unto me knowledge and devotion. Grant that I may have an uninterrupted vision of Thee. A serene peace reigned in my soul. The world was forgotten. Only the Divine Mother shone within my heart. In 1886, Ramakrishna was taken to Kasepur Garden House for treatment of his throat cancer. The disciples of the Master served him with heart and soul. Vivekananda practiced spiritual disciplines under the guidance of the Master and attained Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Ramakrishna said, "Behold, here is Naren. See, see, oh, what power of insight he has. It is like the shoreless sea of radiance. The Mother Mahamaya herself cannot approach more than within 10 feet of him. She is bound by the very glory which she has imparted to him." At Kasipur, the Master transmitted power to Swami Vivekananda and wrote on a paper, "Naren will teach people." Ramakrishna passed away on August 16, 1886. Before passing away, Ramakrishna said to Swami Vivekananda, "He who was Rama and Krishna is now Ramakrishna in this body." The disciples of Ramakrishna renounced the world and moved into a dilapidated house at Baranagore. Vivekananda later told about the first monastery. "There were days at the Baranagore Math when we had nothing to eat. Boiled leaves of the bimba creeper, salt and rice. This was our diet for months. Come what may, we were indifferent. We were being carried on in a strong tide of religious practices and meditation." In his boyhood, Vivekananda used to tell his friends, "I must become a sannyasin. A palmist predicted it." And he would show them a certain straight line on the palm of his hand. Vivekananda had passionate love for freedom, which he mentioned in the song of Sannyasin.
"Have thou no home? What home can hold thee, friend? The sky thy roof, the grass thy bed, and food what chance may bring, well cooked or ill, judge not. No food or drink can taint that noble self which knows itself. Like a rolling river free, thou ever be. Sannyasin bold, say, Om Tat Sat Om."
He traveled all over India, mostly on foot. First, he went to Varanasi, the place of spiritual culture. There, he experienced the glory of Lord Shiva. He visited Saranath, where Buddha gave his first sermon. He went to Ghazipur to see Pauhari Baba, a great yogi. This is the cave where Pauhari Baba lived. One day, a cobra entered that cave. The people who saw it thought that he would be killed from a snake bite. But Pauhari Baba appeared before them, and when asked what happened, he said, "A messenger came from my beloved." Vivekananda, the itinerant monk, visited Ayodhya, the birthplace of Rama, Haridwar, the foothill of the Himalayas, Rishikesh, the place of the ascetics, the Himalayas, the abode of gods, Delhi, the historical city, Taj Mahal of Agra, one of the wonders of the world, and Mathura, the birthplace of Krishna. He then went to Dwaraka, the west coast of India. He crossed the desert of Rajputana. Raja Ajit Singh of Khetri became his disciple. The Raja wanted to entertain Vivekananda. A dancing girl was engaged to sing, but he refused to attend the secular entertainment because he was a monk. Then that girl sang this song.
"Look not, O Lord, upon my sins. Is not same-sightedness thy name? One piece of iron is in the image in the temple, and another, the knife in the hand of the butcher. Yet both of these are turned to gold when touched by the philosopher's stone. So, Lord, look not upon my evil qualities.